Hey guys, welcome to beautiful Austin, Texas, and I'm here with our electric car expert, Anton Wallman, and we're here driving the new Veloster Turbo, but we're not talking about turbos, we're talking about EVs. And Anton, what is happening with Tesla? Will the company make it till the end of the year, or will they go into the toilet?
Well, we have a couple of important questions that we are examining right now. In particular, their financial situation. Tesla has a near-term cash problem.
How much are they burning through?
Well, they're burning a little bit over $1 billion a quarter, and they're losing over $700 million a quarter. They had $2.7 billion of cash on hand at the end of the first quarter that ended at the end of March. However, they also had about $2.3 billion worth of payables that are coming due in the very short term. So, when you look at their cash on hand and you look at their cash outlays just in the next handful of months, things could start to get awfully close.
Do you think, Anton, do you think that Elon still loves being the CEO of Tesla, or is this a hell of his own creation now? Because he tweeted on April 1st, right, that the company has gone bankrupt. It may have been a little bit of like foreshadowing, or at least, you know, a little bit of get me the heck out of this company.
Well, clearly he mentioned at the end of July of last year that he was going to be in production hell for some time.
Yeah.
And we've seen that now for almost a year now, how that is exactly the way it has been playing out. They've missed every target that they've set up for themselves. And now the near-term target is to hit 5,000 to 6,000 cars per week by approximately early July. Will they get there? Will they get there at a particular quality level? Will they get there on any consistent basis? We'll find out here come, you know, July or August. But I think this picture for them, once we go beyond just hitting a volume, it doesn't matter whether it's 5, 6, 10, or 15,000 a week. What matters is, can you make a profit on these cars? And that's where so far they have been earning negative gross margins on this product. That will obviously hopefully change from their perspective. But as long as you're not making a positive gross margin, you're certainly not making a positive net margin, and then you're in deep trouble.
Yeah, I kind of feel like the bill has come due, right? For the longest time, Tesla was like, you know, here's the Model S, but don't look at that, look at the Model 3, and then now the Model 3 is here. Don't look at that. Look at the Roadster that we shot into space. But don't look at that. Look at the pickup truck, right? Or the regular truck. And I kind of feel like Wall Street is at a point where they actually want to see some returns, right? It's not just blue sky. It's actually show us the money.
That's right. So initially, their car was the Roadster, the converted Lotus car. They said, okay, we'll lose money on that, but that is going to fund the Model S where we're going to make money. Well, the Model S never made money. So they said, well, the Model X is going to make money because that is going to be a more expensive car with a higher content. Well, the Model X never made money. But don't worry, we're going to have the Model 3 coming. Now the Model 3 is here in volume, and the Model 3 is not making money. So now, what is possibly going to be the next excuse? Well, we know some of the cards that they are laying on the table. They've already laid a semi-truck card on the table that they say they will start delivering in some as of yet unspecified quantity in 2019. They've shown the Roadster card that they are going to start delivering in some unspecified quantity in 2020. They've said that they're going to start delivering the Model Y, which is essentially the crossover version of the Model 3, also in 2020. Actually, initially they said 2019, but he just recently corrected himself and said, no, it's 2020. Of course, they haven't even started building a factory for a Model Y. Building a factory takes 3 years. You may recall that this last January 2018, Toyota and Mazda jointly announced that they're building a new car factory in Alabama. They said it will start producing cars in 2021. Well, that's somewhere between three and a half years. So you can, you know, for a couple of companies who are extremely experienced in building car factories and doing so profitably, imagine Tesla building a new car factory, whether in the United States or whether they build it in China or somewhere else. Look, you got to add at least 3 to 3.5 years before any of these new products can ever hit the market. But before you can pay for those new factories, you have to fund these new factories. And as it stands right now, they have no money to fund any new factories. So there are all of these things that need to fall into place for any of these new products to make it. That is why, for the near term, the number one goal for the company must be to make the Model 3 profitable at whatever volume.
Yeah, and you know, for all you Tesla fanboys, you may think that we're here kind of knocking on the company, and we're not. You know, TFL, we're reporting the news, and we don't really have a horse in this race. What we do know, though, is that it's very hard, I think, for a company to succeed when it isn't making a profit. And, you know, if they keep burning money at this prodigious rate, one of two things has to happen, right? Someone's going to buy them, and that's a possibility. And one of the traditional car companies could buy them, or somebody like Apple could buy them. Or, you know, there's going to be a reckoning, and they're just going to go bankrupt. I just can't see that this kind of trajectory.
It is a bit of an unprecedented situation, because if you look at the nature of Tesla's financial or capital requirements, the nature of their income statement, the nature of their ownership, and the nature of their liabilities, their debt that's already on the books, we don't really have a precise historical precedent as to how this story would end. There's never been quite a figure like Elon Musk, who has this type of a company, but also has these other side companies. There has never been this other combination of companies in both the automotive industry and coming from the technology industry. So we're very much in an uncharted territory as to how the story would end. My theory, and I'm betting to this effect, is that I do think that at a minimum, the value of this company is going to decline over the next year as the company continues to miss its Model 3 profitability targets. And that is something that would happen irrespective of any new competition coming into play. But what we have, of course, Roman, we also have new competitors coming into the market in the coming months. Maybe we should go over some of those names to refresh people about what's unfolding over the next 12 months.
Yeah, we're here with Hyundai, of course. They've got an EV coming out, as is Kia.
That's so, right. So Hyundai and Kia are essentially sister companies. So both of those companies have EVs in the market already. You know, the Hyundai Ioniq electric has been a big success in their home market in Korea, as well as in a handful of countries in Europe. It was so successful, in fact, that the United States was hardly allocated any quantities. They sold, I think, just a few hundred in California around this time last year, and then basically the spigot stopped. Now, they're coming out with an all-new model, which will be coming into Europe in the third quarter of this year, and which will be arriving in the United States later, probably late October. And it's called a Kona EV, built off of their smallest crossover SUV, the Kona, which in its gasoline form hit dealerships about a month or two ago.
Yeah, we just reviewed that in Hawaii.
That's
right. It's a really nice car. And you were saying it's almost identical in at least size to the Chevy Bolt, and that the new battery in the Kona is just kind of a tweaked version of the Bolt battery.
That's right. So it's interesting that if you look at a Chevy Bolt EV and a Hyundai Kona EV, they look completely different. If you see two pictures of these cars, you'll think that one is from Mars and the other one is from Venus. They're completely different. But the measurements are extremely similar. And the battery and the technology under the skin from LG is also very, very similar. The Kona has just a one half step newer revision of this battery, so it will get just a tiny, tiny, tiny hair longer range, but close enough.
250 miles of range.
Basically, that's what they've said, yeah. So the Kia version of the similar vehicle, they said 238.
Yeah.
I think it's mostly an issue of aerodynamic differences between these two vehicles.
Yeah, and then about 2 weeks, we're actually going to go to Europe and drive the new Jaguar I-Pace, which is very similar kind of in looks to the Kona, right? It's kind of a tall crossover vehicle.
That's right. So the Jaguar I-Pace is a larger vehicle. So it is clearly more space for the rear seat passengers, and it's got a lot more luggage space than the Kona. But the shape of the vehicle, this sort of crossover slash SUV, is in the same genre. But this is a far more upscale vehicle. The base price in the U.S. market, when it goes on sale in the third quarter in the United States, will be $70,495, including destination.
So it's That's basically the Model S competitor.
That's right. So it's funny. It's competes on the one hand with the Tesla Model S, because that's sort of the overall price proposition. It competes in part with the Tesla Model X because it sits a little higher up. It's a so-called SUV crossover, but the Model S X is, of course, a larger three-row. It can tow. On the other hand, you could argue that the Jaguar I-Pace competes a little bit with the Model 3, because if you look at the length and of the vehicle, it is about the same length as the Model 3. So if you take a loaded Model 3 with all-wheel drive, well, it starts to look a lot like a Jaguar I-Pace.
So we'll be reviewing that as well as driving it in a couple of weeks, so stay tuned for that. I'm really excited to go drive it in Europe. You know, I love new tech, and it's cool to see that Jaguar, of all companies, is the first one hitting the market, because of course Audi's coming out with an e-tron as well. But before we talk about more European models, what about the granddad of all these electric cars, the Leaf? There's a new one that came out. How's it selling?
Well, so far, I think the sales in the United States has been a little bit disappointing.
Yeah, I think you're right.
It's selling basically fairly similar right now to the Chevrolet Bolt, despite having a lower base price. We can argue these two cars are not apples to apples. The Chevy Bolt has a far longer range, 238 miles. Versus 151 miles. It has a lot more horsepower, so it accelerates a lot faster. In the base model, you don't get steel wheels. In the base model, you get Android Auto, you get Apple CarPlay, 4G LTE. So there are certain pieces of equipment that the Chevy has that the Nissan does not. On the other hand, you know, the Nissan starts at a lower price. It has the semi-autopilot thing. So the cars are, you know, there are a bunch of puts and takes. But right now, so far in calendar 2018, the sales of both the Chevy Bolt EV and the Nissan Leaf have been very, very poor in the U.S. market. In Japan and in Europe, however, the Nissan Leaf so far has done a lot better. And you can ask yourself why. Well,
yes, I think, it's so expensive.
Well. Think about it. The Chevy Bolt is effectively no longer sold in Europe. You know, GM sold
Opel.
The Opel brand to PSA in Europe, and they had a bit of a, you know, conflict about something. So they essentially cut down on the volumes that they shipped to Europe from their factory in Michigan. And of course, the Tesla Model 3 is not yet on sale either in Japan or in Europe. So if you're a Nissan, you're basically selling this car without a lot of competition, both in Japan and in Europe. So in Europe and Japan, Nissan Leaf is actually showing very, very good sales over there.
And of course, all this really is dependent on the price of gasoline. It continues to be low. The best predictions are that it'll stay that way, but you never know. You know, there's a little bit of unrest in
The last few weeks in the U.S., the gasoline prices have crept up.
They have. It's about $70 a barrel right now.
That's right.
Right from a low of about 50.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. But it has been going up in the last couple of months.
It has.
For sure.
But it's not, you know, people, I think, start making buying decisions when it gets about $4 a gallon. We're still at that $3 level right now.
At least outside of California, yeah. In California, it's the high threes, $3.75.
And here in Texas, we're...
It's a lot lower. We should mention that there is another car that will be unveiled.
Yeah.
Actually, two cars that will be unveiled in their final production form in the month of August. And that those two are, in August, you have the Audi... e-tron, which will be unveiled at its factory in Brussels. And then a couple of weeks thereafter, in September at the Paris Auto Show, we get the Mercedes EQC. These two cars are effectively direct head-to-head competitors with that Jaguar I-Pace.
Yeah, I mean, it's exciting time. So will Tesla survive to the end of the year? Will one of the other car companies come and knock it off the electric crown, knock off its electric crown? You know, these are great questions, and I think we're going to have some really interesting days, as the Chinese proverb goes, right? May you live in interesting days over the next half year before the end of the year. Guys, come back to us when we're in, I think we're going to be in Portugal, right? Driving the new I-Pace, and we'll revisit these questions. As always, this is Roman and my friend Anton here saying thanks for watching, and check out tflcar.com for more news, views, and of course all your electric car reviews. See you guys next time. Ciao.